Thank you. Today, we welcome staff, current and past students, parents and friends as we honour Dr. Mark and Mrs. Sharon Verdell. We also welcome those who have joined us online, including Luke and Joel Verdell. In September 1995, I was settling into a room in Warburton for the sessional meetings for our Victorian conference when a sprightly young man, happened to be Mark Verdell, arrived from Western Australia. I don't know how we ended up in the same room, but I do know that it was God-led. As we began sharing, we came to the realisation that Mark had been asked to take the principal role at Gilson College, as I was being transferred to care for Karralundi Aboriginal Education Centre in Western Australia. It soon became very evident that this was a God-directed meeting. There was a very strong sense that Mark was the man for the job. From the brink of closure, with just 95 students prepped to 10 and a handful of staff, God has guided and blessed from the dusty, wind-swept western plains of Melbourne and brought about the largest Adventist school in the South Pacific over two campuses. God has blessed your ministry, Mark and Sharon, and we will miss you.
I was asked by Mark and the Victorian Conference, but also felt a strong call from God, and my journey with Mark began in January 2002. I was one of a number of many new staff that year who began working at Gilson College, including people like Tony and Marcy Robinson, Lex Goodchild, Mark and Adele Bergman, just to mention a few. I'm not quite sure what I expected when I arrived at Gilson in Victoria, but what greeted me was the desert plains of the Western Volcanic region, dry, barren, and covered in tumbleweed as I ventured into the school grounds for the very first time. I knew that this was where God wanted me to be. Mark, you took a risk, a person unknown with a teaching background, but 28 years of experience within industry and other areas. You gave me a chance, a sea change, and a start to a new and a very rewarding career. And now, 22 years onwards, I still feel that I am at home, where I belong, and where God has definitely called me as a faithful servant. Like others who over the years have joined the Gilson team, I believe that we have been honoured to work with you. I have valued and grown from the internal strength that you gain from your close walk with God. Through your life and your commitment to the role as principal, I have seen the hands and feet of Jesus at work in you. A humble man, where there was nothing that you will not do for the college or the community, the students, the staff, be it mowing the lawns, climbing the rafters of the old assembly area to run cables through it, picking up students from camps, or even unblocking blocked toilets. Nothing was too difficult or beyond you as you worked tirelessly in more than one way for this college. As part of your great leadership, you have not only been a great leader, you have mentored, supported, guided early career teachers, all staff, the leaders that worked with you, students, and many parents. You have always been highly committed and available to each staff member. I knew you always had my back. No matter what, you would be the last man in the ring, either standing in the corner with me or fighting for each one of us in some way when things got really tough. Mark, as a chosen man of God, you have always demonstrated to us the patience of Job, the wisdom of Solomon, and I believe you stand tall and in line with David and can be called a man after God's own heart. You have never been too proud to admit weaknesses, and when you have been wrong or when you have tried doing things in your power, you have openly and honestly then handed these things to God. We have seen miracles occur in front of our eyes. The basketball courts, God's turning lane, the gymnasium we're sitting in, and the Eco Science Centre, just to mention some. As a team, you have also led with courage and devotion, and we have seen the failure of enemy attacks on our college because of your leadership. You have calmly worked with staff. All your decisions have been considered and careful, and your support for the staff and the Gilson team has always been unwavering. We truly have been blessed by your godly leadership and grateful for the strength that you gain from your close walk with God. Through your prayerful guidance, you have worked hand in hand with God to build the Seventh-day Adventist Christian School as we know it here in the western suburbs. As captain, you have worked tirelessly with all of us, and God has blessed the mission of the school in sharing God's words to thousands of students and families over the 26 years you have been here. We would also like to recognise that Sharon has also been a strength and encouragement to you in this journey. And Sharon, thank you for the many sacrifices that you have made, for the internal strength that you too hold, and for the walk with God that you share with Mark. Dr. Mark Vodell, today many of us wonder in our grief how we will move forward without you as our godly leader. You have clearly left an imprint on Gilson College in the work that you have done through and for God. You are leaving a great legacy. A legacy where we, God's true servants, will continue to work with determination to accomplish God's great purpose for Gilson College. Thank you.
When I first came to Gilson College in 1999, I was the man. I'd just come from teaching in London and before that New Zealand, and I thought I knew everything. But it wasn't too long before I put my foot in my mouth. I can't remember the details, but I offended a student, a teacher, a staff member, a parent, I don't know. But I do remember that, Mark, you took me aside and you said with your calm wisdom, maybe don't do it like that. Maybe next time do it like this. And that was the beginning of a long relationship of you trying to cure me of foot and mouth disease. Unfortunately, your work is not over. But I can honestly say that I still hear your voice in my head in class, and without a doubt, I am the teacher I am today because of you. And even though I, as well as many other people in this community, feel grief, anger, frustration, I hear your voice inside my head saying calmly and wisely, it's not about you, it's not about me, it's about them. And I still hear that. So students, if you think Mr. Vodell has impacted your life, I want you to stand up. Current students, from year one all the way through to year 12. If Mr. Vodell has had an impact on your life, stand up to show him. And we can also include the many students who are now staff members that came back to work at Gilson College. Mark, Sharon, this is your legacy, and for this we are all eternally grateful. Thank you.
Good afternoon, all. It's great to see you at this special service to honour Mr. Mark Vodell. I'm coming to you from regional Victoria, where our home is, and my wife and I are currently in isolation because of COVID. Mark and I have known each other since the late 70s, when we were both students at Avondale University. And I'd like to say that bounding across the landscape of educational leadership in Seventh-day Adventist schools in Australia, there is a giant, one who stands heads and shoulders above the rest, Mr. Mark Vodell. Only some of the key strengths and virtues can be fitted into this tribute this afternoon. However, first and foremost, Mark is a fully converted, committed, and congruent follower of God. And this divine connection flows out freely in every aspect of his life in such practical ways. As a vigorous defender of the faith, Mark regularly promotes, extols, presents, and lives Christianity before friend and foe, believer and unbeliever, with the pure intention of sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. At his core, Mark is a family man. As a son, a brother, a husband and father, one who is loved by his family and one who deeply loves his family, all of which is framed by a deep understanding of his own family history. His strong sense of importance of family extends to his professional colleagues and the followers of Jesus Christ, wherever in the world they are found. With this also comes a strong sense of mission. This is evident in his taking Gilson College from a college that was voted to be closed to being the largest Seventh-day Adventist school in the South Pacific Division. In addition, this mission extends to the My Mission Project, which supports a number of schools and orphanages in Myanmar. Mark has annually led a group of staff and Year 10 students on a service trip, while Gilson College pays the annual wages of at least 20 teachers and workers in those institutions in Myanmar. From the beginning of his career, Mark has been a master teacher and leader with a strong visionary drive, always with the view to providing quality Christian education for as many families as possible. This not only included the acquisition of the Mernda campus, but also for future opportunities in the rapidly growing areas in the west and north of Melbourne. Always superbly organised, consulting widely, and with a deep understanding of the human condition, Mark brings wisdom, confidence, solutions, and positivity to problem solving at multiple levels of challenge. Mark is a preacher, a scholar, and now a PhD, and we want to congratulate you, Mark, on receiving your doctorate. He's a brilliant writer, he's very widely read, an adventurer, photographer, master storyteller, empathetic listener, athlete, he's fair and firm, has a magnificent sense of humour, he's always erudite company, always respectful, and is able to light up any room he enters with laughter and joy. Mark, we want to thank you for being the indefatigable and irrepressible person that you are, and for the blessing that you are to all of us with your amazing life. Good afternoon, all. It's great to see you at this special service to honour.
Hello. It's prayer and some memories. Are you ready? Because Mr. Vodell, Mrs. Vodell, the first time I met you, W3 and W5 were being built. It was it had been framed out, and I think the roof was on, and you were giving us a tour of the school. Year 12s, Mr. Vodell always comes on the Year 12 camp, and he's a bit of a stealth man, this guy. He has a habit of not sleeping. So if you try and come out of your cabin after lights are out, beware of bushes, because Mr. Vodell likes to hide behind them and say, "Boo, why are you out of bed?" And I know many students who've gone, "Oh, sorry, sir, we're okay. We're not doing anything wrong." Mr. Vodell's driving. That's a good lesson in prayer and encouragement to build that spiritual connection and pray, "Jesus, keep us safe." No, not that bad. Mr. Vodell, hiking, watching you play paintball, sneaking up on kids and teachers. the hike, the Year 9 program, training.
My impressions. Mark, you're a man of the book. And guys, that means a man of the book, the Bible. Mr. Vodell devotes his life to reading and to following that which is written in God's Word. He and Sharon loved their family, their parents when they were alive, their extended family, and especially their boys. Mr. Vodell loves words and languages. He likes to do things well, and he describes himself as a bit of a perfectionist. He wrote an outstanding doctoral thesis. Mark and Sharon have always shown an unwavering commitment to the school. They are people of integrity and a generosity of spirit. Mark, you walked the fine line of maintaining Adventist special character while at the same time accepting staff like me from other denominations and indeed students from other faiths and even secular backgrounds. You set an agenda where leading people to Jesus through excellence in education was the highest priority at Gilson. I particularly enjoyed our theological discussions. They were challenging, but always permeated with respect, and thank you for those. On a personal note, you waited for us till 3 a.m. in the morning at a hospital when Owen fell at a school event. You drove a bus along with others in the middle of the night to pick James up and all the other year eights when their camp got flooded in down at Wilson's Prom. You employed Joanna and you visited Bethany. Many people have extraordinary and similar memories of you touching their lives in very personal and special ways. Together, you both have modelled courage and faith, and we saw that in the days following Luke's accident. Your commitment to Burma is unwavering. And you even sacrificed that precious beard in order to raise some funds a number of years ago. It is an immense privilege to lead out in prayer this afternoon for Dr. and Mrs. Vodell, for Mark and Sharon. So together, shut your eyes, bow your heads, and we will pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for Mark and Sharon, for the years of service, and for blessing the college under Mark's leadership. Thank you for their energy, for their example of servanthood, and for their model of grace, generosity, and kindness.
We thank you for their sacrificial service to our school community, for their vision, their commitment and dedication to Adventist education. We celebrate their service, their efforts to honour you, God.
Thank you, Lord, for those who now follow you because they heard about you at Gilson. Please continue to bless the Gilson school community just as you have done.
Lord, we pray for blessings for Mark and Sharon. We pray for your guidance and wisdom as they move to the next stage of their lives. We entrust them to your care and your enabling hand. May your hand be upon them forever.
We pray that all that is done and said in this service this afternoon will honour you, Lord, and be pleasing to Mark and Sharon. For your glory and in Jesus' name we ask these things. Amen.
Respected Principal Dr. Mark Verdell, Mrs. Verdell, distinguished guests, heads of school, teachers, non-teaching staff, students, friends and family, welcome to this most memorable of assemblies. Over a term ago, we came before the school body accepting the role of student leadership. It was about new beginnings and working towards a final chapter of our secondary education. Even in our rapidly changing world, we would never have imagined we would so soon be standing before you, bidding farewell to our most respected and loved principal. We had hoped we would be shaking your hand as we graduated at the end of this year, but here we stand.
On behalf of the entire school and all the previous student leaders over the past 26 years, we are honored to be representing the student body, past and present, in acknowledging a wonderful educator, an exceptional leader, and the end of a significant chapter in the history of Gilson College. You have been a pillar of strength for us all, always ready to share a story, an experience, or more importantly, ready to listen to our cares and concerns. For those of us who have only known you as our principal, it will take some time to adjust that you are leaving us as you took it for granted that Mr. Verdell and Gilson College were synonymous and therefore would forever be there. No doubt this moment will with time carry even more significance, and your advice, counsel and wisdom will surface in the recesses of our memories at crucial moments in our lives.
And as spoken in a famous film, Mr. Holland's Opus, please look around you. There is not a life that in this room that you have not touched. And each one of us is a better person because of you. Undoubtedly, each of us has a Mr. Verdell story, and collectively we've had many great times, some struggles, numerous laughs, most of all, many fond memories we will cherish for a lifetime. As the Easter period is only a week away, it is fitting to point to this pivotal Bible story and truth where all hearts were filled with sadness and mixed emotions as the disciples' leader hung on the cross. It is a story of hope restored, where sadness is turned to joy and Jesus' resurrection brings indescribable hope.
We are reminded that with God, there is always new hope and life and purpose. On the one side, there is a sense of sadness that our principal is leaving us. But on the other hand, there is an awesome responsibility we all face. Students and staff continuing the wonderful legacy, the next phase of our purpose in this school community. Mr. Verdell, for decades you have scripted respect, responsibility, and love towards God and each other into every assembly, address, newsletter, casual conversation, or lesson that you took, always prompting deeper thinking and considering it's worth a thought. Repeatedly, you have said that education is more than merely getting good grades. It's about integrity and character.
You have modeled Matthew 6:19-20. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and steal. This is the most memorable lesson you have given us, and you have modeled that you cared for all of us. Thank you, we will miss you. Because of this, together as a school, we have great hope. We can build upon the great foundational legacy you have given us and continue to care for each other and a higher purpose of storing treasure in heaven.
As we bid you farewell and wish you all the best in your future life, we know God will continue to bless you in your work as he has blessed you and all of us under your watchful care here at Gilson College. We look forward to hearing what great adventure you will take up next. And please, never hesitate to come back to us, just in case you need our guidance and support. With all our hearts, we say thank you for your service and care. God bless you, Mr. and Mrs. Waddell. Thank you.
Can Mr. Waddell please come up onto the stage?
Good afternoon, everyone. Before the primary school captains, make a presentation to Dr. Mark. I would like to take this time to reflect a little bit about Dr. Mark. My name is Dube. I am the chair for the school council. I'm standing here representing the parents, the college, and I've worked with Dr. Mark in the college for such a long time. What I appreciate most about him is his insight, his foresight, the wisdom, the ability to turn a story into a life lesson. He would talk about stories that are quite funny, that would have a lifelong lesson to all of us. I appreciate Dr. Mark because some 5 years ago, he took trouble running around the streets of Kuala Lumpur looking for a cake because it was my daughter's birthday. Everything he did, he took it personal. He knew every child by name. He related to the old, the staff, the children, and gave value to who they are. And because of his insight and foresight, I look at a college, Gilson College, that was earmarked for closure, and look at it now as one of the biggest colleges in the Adventist schools, because of the work he has put in and his understanding that he is a minor partner and that there is a bigger partner who runs these colleges. I think that the state of our colleges is strong because of that understanding. He understood that his hand is held by the hand of the bigger partner for these colleges. And he never took anything for granted. And because of that, a lot of us, as parents, we take pride in who our children have grown up to be. The preacher says, everything has got time, seasons for everything. I would have wished that this season would come during its time, unlike the weather in Melbourne. I wish we could have prepared for this season. However, because there is a bigger partner in this venture, I am confident that all is going to be well. And the staff, I would say also to the leadership of the colleges, God has a plan. And his plan is still on course. I thank you. I would like to take this time to introduce Brooke and Austin. They're going to make a presentation to Dr. Mark and Ms. Waddell. Thanks.
I'd just like to say a hearty amen to everything that's been said thus far. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Linnell Newman-Salter, and I've been at this school 1 year longer than Mark. Mladen was also supposed to join me on the platform, but unfortunately he can't be with us. So I think I'm in quite a good position to reveal or conceal past history that we as colleagues have experienced. However, I'm not going to dwell on that. That will come at a later date. I've been very privileged to share the journey of the past 26 years with this multi-talented and amazing administrator. And we as a school community honour and salute you and praise God for what has been accomplished through you. I am not a public speaker, but I know one who is. And so I invite you, Mark, to come to the platform now.
Well, the longer we stay here, the more classes we get out of, eh? I know that there's a few people there up the back that are saying, yes, just stay there for a bit longer, Mr. V, and we can get rid of the whole afternoon, eh? Yeah. Look, let me just say a big thank you to the kind words that you have heard mentioned here this morning, this afternoon rather. I feel a little unworthy as to some of the things that have been said, and I suppose that as Mancini, our college council chair, indicated, I've always maintained that there is a partnership and God is the senior partner and I am the junior partner. I am the replaceable part. He is the irreplaceable part. And so I'll just get started, eh? It was 26 years ago that my wife and I were living in Western Australia. We had a new house. We were living in a place called Les Murdies, for those of you who know the WA. We overlooked the city of Perth, and it was a 15-minute pushbike ride for me into the Bickley Valley to get to work. Our children had been born in the local hospital. We had a sanitarium health food factory on the campus. We were one of six families that had just established a church. And while it was extra work, I enjoyed working with those students who lived in the dormitories, because that college was and still is a boarding school. And I guess life was pretty good. I never wanted to live in Sydney or Melbourne. However, as you heard earlier, I was over here on some meetings, for some meetings in late 1995. And it was at that stage, while I was here, that I was asked to be the principal of Gilson College. Now, some people aspire to be the boss. That is, they want to be the boss. They'll do what it takes to be the boss. But that's never been me. I've been a reluctant principal. I've always found myself in my happy place when I've been on the basketball courts being beaten by the students, in a classroom, on a camp, or running the My Mission trip. So while I was here, they asked me, come out and visit the college. And at that stage, as you heard, it was a dirt road. You had an outback Australian experience every time you went to go to work. It was pretty rough. There was no houses in any of this area here at all. It was just one big grass paddock. And there was one building and a handful of portables plonked in the middle of that grass paddock. And it looked very ordinary. I remember climbing onto the plane as I flew back to Perth thinking, I don't want to live in Melbourne. I don't want to be a principal. And the school is in a lousy spot and it's obviously struggling. But then a remarkable thing happened. For the next 4 hours as I flew across the continent, there was this really, really strong impression that I could not shake, that God wanted us to be here. When I got home, I described the place to my wife and then said, I think we should go. And you should have seen the eyebrows shoot up, both of them, and they stayed up for quite some time. 6 months after we got here, the head office voted to close down many of our schools, including Gilson College, due to financial reasons. And I recall the meeting where we were able to delay that decision. And then in the meantime, God blessed our little school immensely. When I walk around this campus, I see the evidence of answered prayers. The road out the front, the turning lane that you heard mentioned, the lake next door, the basketball courts. Actually, that one there is a result of students' prayers that showed me that I didn't actually have the faith. And it was students that said, we're going to pray for that. That's an amazing story, that one. Let me tell you, I'd love to take the credit for some of those things. But when you hear the stories, you know that it's the major partner, the main man upstairs that deserves the credit. I would like to thank the many people that have worked with us over the years, that have been on the journey, and that have worked hard to provide a place where one can get a great education and at the same time be introduced to the Creator God of the universe. Thank you. I have not always been a Christian, not always a Seventh-day Adventist. But our family wanted to try and make sense of the world that we live in. And we began to explore the big questions in life. Where do I come from? What are my origins? And then at the other end, what happens to me when I die? Unless you answer those questions for the beginnings and the end, then all the stuff in the middle, which is called life, can become meaningless. And our family was trying to make sense and find meaning. And we discovered the Adventist Church, a group that worshipped on Sabbath, believed Jesus was coming again soon, and that there are three angels with three messages. I spent a good deal of time studying, and I continue to look for the evidence for Christianity and for what it is that we believe. I have read most of the sacred texts from the major religions, from Baha'i to Zoroastrianism. And I've only found two that have that intellectual coherence and the evidence to back them up. The first one is what the Jews call the Tanakh. Christians call it the Old Testament. And in the Jewish part of those scriptures, there are 300 predictions about the Messiah. Where he would be born, when he would be born, where he would grow up, that he would be ambushed and betrayed for 30 pieces of silver, that he would be mocked, he would be crucified, that he would die with bad people, but he would get buried with rich people. And that people would gamble for his clothes when he had died. The maths on one man fulfilling the probability of all that happening is 10 to the power of 17. That's a 1 with 17 zeros beside it. If we were to cover the entire state of New South Wales with coins about a half a metre deep and then bury one that had a little mark on it and then sent a blind man to walk across the state and ask him to bend down and dig or pick up one coin at random, that's 10 to the power of 17. The second sacred scripture that I have found that has got intellectual coherence and evidence to back it up is known as the Christian Bible, and you'll find Christians refer to it as the New Testament. And it introduces us to the man Jesus Christ. And we find Jesus fulfilling all those prophecies. But then he goes on to make a stack of his own predictions. He made some rather incredible claims. He said that Jerusalem would be destroyed, that the temple would be removed, that he would die, and then he would come back to life again, that he would go to heaven, and that he would make a place for you in heaven. And he would come back to get you and take you there. I mean, that's pretty amazing. I mean, the Bible uses a lot of symbols. And when you understand symbols, life makes sense. In this city, we use symbols all the time. If I was to say to you that the Magpies are playing the Cats this weekend, you would all know that a team based in Collingwood was playing a team based in Geelong. And if I said to you that the Eagles were flying high, I guess there'd be a lot of you that would disagree with me. I can almost hear that song, flying high. Yeah, I won't sing it. All right, yeah. We know when we understand the symbols, it makes sense. And the Bible uses lots of them. In fact, one of them that they use to talk about Jesus is the Lamb. And in fact, I can sum up the entire Bible just using seven words to make it easy for us all. The Old Testament, the Tanakh, can be summed up by the words spoken by Isaac when he was climbing up that mountain with Abraham, his father, and they were going to sacrifice there for God. And he looks around and he says, we've got everything, but where is the Lamb? Four words. That's it. The whole of the Old Testament is just four words. It's all about where is the Lamb? Where is the man? Where is the Messiah? Where is the person that is going to make sense out of all this and make it all good? And then the New Testament, we go to that little spot in Israel where John the Baptist is on the side of the Jordan River. And I've had the privilege of walking along the Jordan River with my wife. And as you walk along there, you can just imagine John the Baptist baptizing people there. And he looks up and he sees Jesus there. And he says three words, behold the man. That's the entire New Testament summed up. It's kind of telling us, here he is. Where is the Lamb? Behold the Lamb. Seven words. The Bible is the only book that I've ever read that has the audacity, that dares to predict the future and get it right every time. You see, Jesus has made a whole stack of predictions as well. And apart from one, they've all taken place. The one that hasn't? It's the part where he said, I promise to come back. And I guess I've studied the evidence for his first visit, and that's why I'm so confident about the second visit. You know, sometimes I come across people and they say to me, oh, Mark, are you fair dinkum? Do you really think that a bloke's going to come out of the sky? Seriously? Well, yeah, I do. 8,000 schools, just like this one, right round the world, have been established by the Adventist Church to let people know that Jesus is coming back. And we have the evidence for it. I remember sitting down with a friend one time that I guess had a lot of questions and doubts, and he said, Mark, there are millions of people that haven't even heard the name Jesus Christ. How's it going to work for them? How's it going to work? And it was years ago, and I said to him, I don't know. I don't know. But do you know that since the year 2000, Jesus has been appearing to Muslims in dreams and visions all around the world, inviting them to follow him? You probably didn't know that, did you? But there is a website called Dreams of Isa, ISA, Dreams of Isa. And you can read the stories there of people who have had dreams. And the people that run that website receive reports from people. 120 countries every month are represented there. They don't have that on the Channel 9 news at 6 p.m. But what you will find on that website is people posting their dreams and asking, what does it mean? I had a dream. And I saw a man in white. And he was talking to me. And he said, there were three angels with three messages. Can you tell us what that means? You see, the Muslims are saying that Jesus is coming back. Dreams of Isa, check it out. My wife and I spend 15 minutes every day, which allows us to read through the entire Old Testament and the New Testament every year. I don't recommend that, because there are some sections that are quite difficult to understand, particularly when you don't understand the symbols or the ancient context. But what I do recommend is one book that you read. What book do you think I would recommend? Oh, look at all the hands go up. Down the front here, would you like to tell me? What book do you think I might recommend? The Bible, but there's one book inside the Bible. Which book do you think I might recommend? Yes, Proverbs, it's a good book, excellent, but that's not the one. Yes, you're so close. All right, I'm going to have one more chance. Yes. Daniel's a very good book, but I'm going to recommend, it's a very deep book and complex, right? But the book that I'm going to recommend is the book of Mark. That should be an easy one to remember. Do you know that it's, of the Gospels, it's the shortest one, and when you see me, you should be able to remember that too. Read the book of Mark. If you read a little section of it every day and think about it, it will change your life and it will help you understand the chaos in which we live. You know, last year during the pandemic and the lockdowns, the college received a phone call from one of our families. And they asked to speak to me because they had some questions, apparently. They left a message with the receptionist. And this was during the time when they were having lockdowns and people were losing their jobs and their businesses, and the whole world seemed to be going crazy. And this family had a really strange question. The mother asked, is all this craziness related to the mark of the beast and the end of the world? Now, some of you will be sitting here going, what's the mark of the beast? Well, let me tell you that in the New Testament, there is a little section in Revelation that identifies that you don't want the mark of the beast. It's a symbol that you have given your allegiance to the bad side rather than the good side. That you've gone to the bad and you've rejected the Creator God. So I let the family know that COVID, forced vaccines and lockdowns were not the mark or the symbol of the beast. And the response was, but I've read in the Bible somewhere where it says that you won't be able to buy and sell. And, you know, surely, what's it all got to do with? And I said, you know what? You're right. You're referring to a passage in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 17. She said, you're familiar with it? I said, yes, I am. And I said, if you read that chapter in its context, you will find that there will be a word repeated again and again and again. Seven or eight times there's this word in chapters 13 and 14. And it tells us what it's all about. I said, it's just one word. She said, what's that word? I said, I told you, it's in chapters 13 and 14. You read it. She said, oh, don't be like that. Just tell me the answer. Just tell me. And I said, okay. I got a little weak. And so I told her. And I'm going to tell you too. The word is worship. Worship. It's repeated again and again. And it tells us that that's what the mark of the beast is all about. But I did say to her, this isn't about COVID and so on. But what you have learned is that this has been a good practice run. And if our world ever gets there and starts to make mandates about worship, who you can worship, how you worship, when you worship, then you will recognize and you will know that it is not from God. If there is nothing else that you have remembered, remember that. Because we live in a very volatile world, a very changeable world. And you need to know what comes from God and what doesn't. Speaking of change, in the meantime, Mrs. Bodell and I are going to have a new chapter. We will, over the next couple of months, be moving to the Hunter Valley, which is where we both grew up as children. In fact, in year seven, Mrs. Bodell was my girlfriend. And today, she still is. I want to make it very clear to you in closing that we are not moving because I didn't like my job or the people that I work with or the students of this great college. I can tell you, we will miss you. Over the years, there have been thousands of people that we've got to know and love. And I've had emails, until recently, and texts and phone calls that have been overwhelming. And we are humbled by the appreciation and the gratitude that has been shown to the people who know us. However, now that the decision has been made, we focus on the positives and we will be closer to our family. Our children live in northern Sydney, and we will be closer to them as well. The weather will allow me to use my mini moke a little more often. And if some of you are wondering what's a mini moke, it's parked in front of the library out the front there where I often park my other car, and you'll see it there this afternoon. You're not allowed to climb in it. I know it doesn't have doors, but that's no excuse that you can sit in there. That's a good question. Is it locked? Yeah, it's got an ejector seat in it. Finally, we know that God is faithful. And stories from the Bible like Daniel and Joseph have inspired me and demonstrate that we rely on God. All other ground is sinking sand. Actually, those words come from an old hymn that states that Christ is the solid rock on which we stand. I could sing it, but I won't, unless we need the building cleared rapidly. And on that note, pun intended. May God bless you and the families that you represent abundantly.
You know what blows me away? Dr. Vodell could have come up here and talked about himself and his achievements, and yet he chose his last address to you as the family of Gilson College to acknowledge his Lord and Saviour and to give one last chance, an appeal to every single one of you to know the love of Jesus that he has in his heart. And I just want to acknowledge you, Mark, for that incredible speech. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jacques Kelly, and it's an honour for me today to represent the National Office of Adventist Education in Australia. And today, on behalf of Adventist Schools Australia, I want to add our best wishes to Dr. Vodell and thank him for his service to Adventist education, especially here at Gilson College. As you've already heard, for 26 years, he has led this place with distinction. I remember when this school had just a few students and the road out the front was gravel and it was slated to be closed. And then came along Mr. Vodell. And as you've already heard, Gilson College is one of 48 Adventist schools around Australia, and Gilson College is the largest Adventist school in our system. And much of that credit must go to you, Dr. Vodell, for your vision and for your drive, and for that I thank you very much. They say that the average teacher impacts 3,000 students over the course of their career. And as I look around here today, and as I walked in here and I saw the love that you all have for Mr. Vodell, I am sure that your impact goes far beyond 3,000 students. Mark, there will be people in the kingdom of heaven because of your love for Jesus and for your intentionality to share that love of Jesus with your students and your staff. Don't ever forget that. So, Dr. Vodell, thank you for your service. Thank you for your ministry. And may God richly bless you and Sharon in the next chapter of your life. God bless.
Thank you. I gotta say this. When Mr. Vodell said to me he was gonna talk for 7 minutes, I thought, I forgot that it's his 7 minutes. I was counting markets more than 10, hedging on 20, possibly. Over the years, Mr. Vodell, being the consistent person that he is, has always wanted a school choir. So we had a school choir, then we didn't. Today, you have one. When Mrs. Tolher sent out the message for students and staff to sing a song for this occasion, well, as you can see, we have had a fair bit of response. So well done, students and staff. The song they will sing, I have been told, is one of Mr. Vodell's favorite songs. And it simply says, thank you. Thank you for giving to the Lord. And for me, I'm sorry, bear with me. It depicts this principle of ours, who has poured his heart, poured himself into this school. So these young lives that we are responsible for and privileged to educate are guided into being men, young men and women of integrity that can be the change. We should never underestimate the impact we have on these students that have been entrusted into our care. If all we do in this lifetime is to bring one life, just one life, to Christ, or show our students and community a glimpse of heaven, then it has not been in vain. And this is the legacy that our principal leaves behind. So, Mr. Vodell, Mrs. Vodell, parents, staff, and students present and past, here is the Gilson College Choir singing thank you, especially for you.
Thank you for giving to me. could see each life somehow touched by your generosity. Little things that you had done and sacrifices you made, they were unnoticed on this earth, in heaven now proclaimed. And I know up in heaven you're not supposed to cry, but I'm almost sure there were tears in your eyes as Jesus took your hand and you stood before the Lord. He said, my child, look around you. Great is your reward. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am a life that was changed. Thank you for giving to the Lord. I am so glad you gave. I am so glad you gave.
Somebody was cutting onion on that side. Dear Mark, Sharon, students, staff, parents and friends, we are getting closer to the end of this beautiful program. But before we finish, I would like to say thank you to Dr. Vordell for inviting me to join this college 13 years ago. On the 12th of January 2009, following an interview with Dr. Vordell, I started teaching here. I don't remember the questions you asked me, but I do remember what you said at the end of the interview. You said, Peter, I like your enthusiasm and your smile. I'm hoping you saw more than just those two things. On a serious note, Mark, thank you for being a great mentor for all of us. Thank you for being a spiritual leader, an educational giant with even greater humility. Thank you for sharing your stories with me and many of us. Thank you for leading this school with a great heart. If you look around and look at these students, young and old, they are the letters you are sending out to the four corners of this world. You know, some people, they built pyramids in the past. Others fought and conquered nations with force. Still others focused on advancing their great career. You, however, built a shelter for kids in this world where love, kindness, and humility are quickly disappearing. Dr. Vordell, Master Teacher, you are not leaving buildings behind. That's not your legacy. You are leaving people behind with capital letters, people who cannot be bought and sold because you taught them, people who with the accuracy of a compass will always point to the truth, even when truth is unpopular. Thank you for that. This great ship of Gilson College will be sailing on towards unknown waters today. Unfortunately, without the two of you. But the furnaces are roaring and glowing. The engines are running hot because 26 years ago, someone, and that was you, pushed the throttle to full steam and you said, all hands on deck, and you meant it. And if I look up to see who's guiding this great ship, I see Jesus steering it. We might encounter storms, but we know we are in good hands. And even if we don't see the two of you until the very end, your words will keep ringing in our ears. Nihil sine Deo, nothing without God. That's your legacy. I want to finish with a quote from Antoine de Saint-Exupéry's novel, The Little Prince. You're probably familiar with this little book, a book that's so dear to my heart. And place a quote on everybody's hat as we close. It says, "And now, here is my secret," said the fox to the little prince. "It is only with the heart that one can see rightly. What is essential is invisible to the eye. What is essential is invisible to the eye." God bless you, Mark, Sharon. God bless you, students. God bless you, staff and parents. God bless you all.
We're going to bring this ceremony, this occasion to a close. And before we do that, I had the privilege of working with Mark 5 days, but I also had the privilege of working and serving alongside him on the 6 day Sabbath for the past 12 years, and that's something special. And when I was the senior chaplain here, there is something that kept me going and I know protected this school. You see, every time Mark would walk down to my office, I would think, he's most probably going to need me to help a student out or to do something. But he would walk down to my office, and the thing he would say is, "We need to pray. We need to pray." And we would sit there, and we would pray about anything and everything. We did this often. Mark's a praying man. And this college was built on the back of prayer. Everything that was done was built on the back of a prayer. It is fitting that we bring this to a close with a prayer. Can I invite the rest of you to just stand quietly as we close in prayer? Oh, Father God, we thank you so much for being here. We have felt your presence, and we know that you have promised that when we all come together, whenever we meet under your name, you are present. And Father, for the last few moments, we have sat and we have reflected, we have heard from your servant, Dr. Vodell, who has led this school, this campus, this community, this family in such a powerful way in the past 26 years. Because it hasn't been curriculum at the top. It hasn't been education at the top. It's been you, Father, that Dr. Vodell has placed priority over everything else, and everything else would fall into place. And as him and Sharon prepare to make their way and move to closer to family, Father, We ask that you pour your blessing upon them. As the prayers of the priest would pray over the people in the Old Testament, may your blessing be upon them both. May your favor be upon them. And may your eyes be upon them, Lord. May you take them, protect them, and carry them on and forward in their journey. Thank you for these moments, these times, and these years that we've had with Dr. Vodell and Mrs. Sharon. Thank you, Father God. We love them both, and the greatest news is that this isn't a goodbye. It's a see you later, because you're coming back soon to take us all home to the kingdom that you have prepared for each and every one of us here. So bless us now, Lord. Thank you for being present. Let everyone say, Amen. Just invite the choir just to make your way back to your seats quietly. Thank you.